Come.
It's Jordy here for CineCam.net, and welcome to Copycat Friday! Woohoo! This is the famous weekly series where we recreate an effect or film technique. And this week, the Oscar nominations of 2018 have got our attention. We have taken three films from the Best Picture list, plus one extra that we believe should have been on the list, and we're going to recreate a scene in terms of costume and lighting, and then match the color grading of these shots to the original films. Darkest Hour and The Shape of Water both play in an underground scenery, so we're heading off to the garage. After we kicked out Janek the Giant, we were able to prepare everything from Darkest Hour. We're now setting up the lights and kind of recreating the scene where Winston Churchill is having a staff meeting, and then we can use that as an example to showcase you how the color grading is done. Now this film has very low contrast, a very dark tone over the entire film, very pale, dead skin tones, and that makes the entire film look very grungy, very rough. So Janek is going to play Winston Churchill. He's preparing himself. Look at that. You're so handsome, Janek. Justine is going to be so jealous. When you want to recreate a certain look, it's important to preserve as much information in your picture as possible. Now with this I mean that you shoot film flat, in a low contrast. If your camera allows, please shoot in a log format. We are shooting on the Panasonic GH5 in V-Log, and if this all sounds Chinese to you, unless you are Chinese, I highly recommend to check out our video about picture styles. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. I'm gonna go fast over the workflow of color correction and grading. If this is all new to you, I highly recommend to check out our in-depth class about color correction inside Adobe Premiere Pro for beginners. After this online class, you'll be familiar with all the controls and know about what is all possible and how a typical color grading workflow looks. You can get access to the class for only 99 cents in your first 3 months by following the first link in the description below.
When will the lesson be learned? You can't reason with a tiger when your head is in his mouth!
Now, recreating the look of a film is not easy. Color grading is one thing, but you'll find out that it's hard to match the actual look if your lighting, costume and all are not the same. So you could either analyze those things as well from the film or live with it that you can only match the color tones, but not the actual mood. When I start matching colors, I divide my shots into 5 parts. You have the blacks, these are the absolute darkest areas of your shot, and they usually have little detail and are the first one to get underexposed. Next up you have the shadows, and these are a little brighter than the blacks, but still considered as the dark areas. And these parts have good detail, and you want to keep the detail in there. Next up are the midtones, and usually you'll find the skin tones in here as well. A little brighter are the highlights. Within the highlights you should always see detail. These are the bright areas, but never overexpose them. And finally are the whites, and these are the absolute brightest spots. Sometimes these areas can be overexposed, definitely if you are filming into the sun or another light source. So these are the 5 layers of exposure in your shot. We can change the brightness of each of these layers individual and change the colors of each of these layers as well. By the way guys, if you stay till the end of the video, you'll actually find a pretty cool surprise related to this topic. We'll be using Lumetri inside Premiere Pro for color grading, and under the Basic Correction tab, you'll find the controls that can adjust 4 of these layers. We have the blacks, shadows, highlights, and whites. Each of these sliders control the exposure of that layer. But as you do so, important to know is that it will also affect the surrounding layers as well. For example, if you would make the shadows darker, so will the blacks and the midtones. So what I like to do now is take a frame grab from the film and look at those layers in there as well. Now before we start, I'm first going to transform my flat picture that was shot in log to Rec 709. I've shot on the Panasonic GH5, so on the internet I found a V-Log to Rec 709 LUT from the Panasonic website. I can apply that through the LUT input above. And this will set a default contrast and saturation from which we can start. The benefit of this workflow is that we always have the information from our log available. So if we would film directly into that Rec 709 standard, then that contrast and all is baked into the clip and we have less freedom when color correcting. Now, if you didn't shoot in lock but just flat, you can just continue without adding a LUT to it. Usually, I start with the highlights, and typical for cinematic films is that they preserve a lot of detail on here. So in most cases, I'm bringing down this value. For darkest hour, I'm even going to go beyond minus 100 by changing my value on the number. Because looking at the original, we notice that the highlights come quite close to the midtones. It's a very dark scene. But because we're pushing so hard on those highlights, the layers around it will go down a little too. And you can definitely see that in the absolute white areas, like here with the lamp in the background or Janik's key light. It's starting to look gray. So what I'll do next is increase the whites. What we are doing now is creating more contrast in the brighter parts of your shot. You can definitely see it here well in the lamp in the background. Here's a before and after. This is a very common technique, and we'll actually use this more often throughout the video. Sometimes the same thing is done with the shadows and the blacks, but not in this example. Furthermore, I will just keep fine-tuning this shot through the other exposure controls. I tend to decrease the exposure many times, but that will lower the whites as well, so you want to compensate for that by increasing the whites even more. You can change one thing and another one comes with, so that's why you typically want to go back and forward between the different controls. After you believe you got it all right, we can focus on the colors. And there are four controls that I use on a basic grading to alter the colors in these levels. First up is the white balance. These will alter the colors everywhere. So if there's a very big color shift needed, I tend to change it first here. I'm going to add some orange into the shot, but that will make it a little bit reddish, definitely in the skin tones. So I'm going to compensate by adding some green into the shot. And this will give it a more yellowish tone overall. Next, I'm going to dive into the color wheels, and here we can find the other three controls: shadows, midtones, and highlights. The benefit here is that we have some more control of how much we want to add in each level and which type of orange-yellow. Because we are pushing so much yellow into the shot, the shadows tend to look too orangey as well. So that's why I'll add the opposite color in here to compensate. Add a little bit of blue, but not too much. You don't want to see a blue color cast in this shot. Next, I'm going to bring down the exposure of the shadow control. Now, adjusting your exposure through the color wheels has the advantage that it takes both the shadow and the blacks level together. And that way, we can take that entire group and make it darker. For the final touch, I'm going to go back into the basic correction and lower the saturation, which will give it that kind of sepia look. And while you're doing this, you might want to go back into some other controls, adjust a little bit there, and then come back. That is how the workflow of color grading goes. One of the final things that I want to go into is the creative tab and increase the faded film. And this will make the shot appear more flat without losing contrast. It kind of takes the edge off the deep blacks, making it look more like film. You can also see it as a layer of cigarette smoke, perhaps, which would fit within that underground meaning. Next up is The Shape of Water, and it's about this girl who falls in love with a sea monster. Now, the tints of this film is very dirty, 60s look also a little bit, very low saturated as well, low highlights, but there's always one color in specific that is more saturated than the rest. And that's also because of the great costume and set design in that film, but it's always somewhere in the cyan teal tint.
I don't have a zipper!
Jenning broke his zipper!
Over here, we have the camera, and Janik is all ready. I am ready too, so let's shoot this scene.
Eliza, come on!
The scenery, lighting, and costume was a lot more complex in this shot, but we have an example shot where we paid attention to the overall color tones. The contrast is a lot bigger than before. The highlights also are stronger and the blacks are much deeper. So starting off, we again pull down the highlights and increase the whites. The black go down too and the shadows as well a little bit. You might want to regulate the overall contrast too. We'll make it warmer through the temperature and add some green in there as well. The set and practical lights have a green tint, so they probably didn't color grade it like this, but we will. Under the color wheels, I'm making the midtones and highlights a bit warmer, but I'm tending a little more towards that green side as I do so. This will make the shot appear flat again, because the shadows are too warm. So, like before, add the opposite color to compensate, and remember to go a little bit into the magentas, as that is the opposite of green. And lastly, I'm going to pull down the saturation to take that video look away. Now you'll notice that our vivid teal cyan color is gone, and this was something typical in the film. So what we want to do next is select that specific color and saturate it more. We can do so from the Curves tab. Click to make a color selection in the wheel, in this case it's around to teal, and then increase that saturation. Looking at the before and after, it came out pretty great. And here's a side-by-side comparison, I believe that we did a pretty good job. Alright, it's time to break everything apart right here in the garage and head over upstairs into the living room, because we are going to shoot a scene from Blade Runner. Sea stands laying around. We have a plan, Janik. So in this part, we're going to recreate a scene from the Blade Runner, and this is the part where the Blade Runner himself meets Indiana Jones or Han Solo. Kind of weird what he's doing in that film. Anyways, we're gonna have to look at some big windows to kind of recreate that futuristic living room scene.
I know. And I want to ask you some questions.
Blade Runner has very orangey, warm scenes, but also a big contrast. And what is, however, noticeable is that they do preserve the highlights a lot. So even though that the blacks are quite deep, I am pushing down the exposure and highlights a lot as well. With the shadow slider, we can control the contrast over my face as well. Next, I'm adding a ton of orange into the shot, but I do not compensate with green, as we want to keep that orange look, not yellow. In the color wheels, it becomes interesting. The midtones get a ton of more orange, the highlights a little bit less to preserve some color differences. Usually the highlights are always a little less extreme than the midtones. Now what they've done with the shadows is quite interesting. Instead of pushing in blue to compensate, they have leaned a bit more towards the green side. And if you pay attention, that green even becomes visible. I'm going to decrease the exposure for the shadows and midtones here as well to really give it that deep contrast against the low highlights. In that film, we also see a ton of mist coming from the sand, and they drew that line further inside as well. So I'm going to add a bit of faded film to make the shadows more pale. Here's the film and our shot side by side. So that was it for Blade Runner. We're now going to focus on Dunkirk, and we actually shot some war film scenes a couple years back, so we're just going to use those shots. They were pretty awesome, so let's dive into Premiere Pro and see how we can create this. Unlike you might think about war films, Dunkirk actually has quite vivid colors and deep contrasts. They even went for the typical teal and orange look. In the basic correction, I lower my highlights and increase the contrast a bunch. And this is actually already enough. You might want to go into the other controls, but the adjustments will be minor. Most of our work is done in the color wheels again. And this time you can add a clean orange into the midtones and highlights and a clean teal into the shadows. Now, to make the look appear a little more like an old war film, they did add more orange into the highlights, which is a more uncommon task. I also like to decrease the shadows in here. Finally, I'm going to go into the curves because I want to highlight the cold a bit more. That's why I'm decreasing the saturation of the orange colors and increasing the saturation of the blue. Again, a side-by-side comparison. Do keep in mind that our scenery and lighting is not the same, but the exposure levels and the colors should match. So I said there was going to be a little surprise by the end of the video. Well, you can actually download the project file and see the individual settings that we've done. Also, we have exported every color grade to a LUT, so by importing this LUT, you have an instant color grade in your shot that matches the look of one of these films. Do, however, keep in mind that you might want to go into your controls to steer a little bit. Every shot is different in terms of exposure, scenery, lights, costume, etc., so treat every shot uniquely. You can find a download link in the description below, and make sure to check out our color grading class as well to help you get started with color correction and grading faster. Thank you so much for watching, and as always, stay creative.
Focus. Focus. Worse.